Metal Slug 2.
Hard to believe it's been 4 years since I recorded the first Metal Slug, the very first game I recorded for the show. Now over 100 games later, I'm returning to the series with Metal Slug 2. Not just that, but this video will also include its update, Metal Slug X. Both of these games are being played on the same Metal Slug Anthology disc on the PS2 that I used for the first game. It's been 2 years since the first game, where Marco and Tama put a stop to General Morden and his rebellion. Morden was believed to be dead, but new groups sympathetic to his cause teamed up to form a new enemy, leading to the conclusion that he must still be alive to lead them. Marco and Tama, having since been promoted, are sent out to deal with it. But this time they are joined by two newcomers from a separate branch of the regular army called the Sparrows, Eric Asamoto and Theo Jeremy. Our first mission is Drifting in the Desert. For this level I'll be playing as Marco. In this playthrough I have my little brother playing as Tama. Partially because I was watching over him at the time, so I put a game on we can both play. Partially because I wanted to check if there was a change in ending between the single and multiplayer like the first game had. There isn't. Gameplay wise it's pretty much the same as the first game. We start with the pistol with infinite ammo and 10 bombs we can throw, along with a knife when attacking an enemy up close. We still have the prisoners of war giving us rewards for saving them, like the returning
heavy machine gun.
This time we have more than just rebel soldiers as enemies. Since Morden's army has expanded further across the world, here we have them with scimitars. Some do have guns though, like this one hiding in a basket of fruit atop a camel. Some will also throw their swords down at us. There'll be a captain commanding a reversing truck towards us, but everyone who comes after us gets blown into chunks while he escapes. We catch up to him again, but he flees and leaves us with the level's mid-boss, the Mosk Artillery. It's 3 men at the top, each with their own missile launcher. But with a heavy machine gun, we easily blow them out of the air one by one. After this, we finally meet some of the normal rebels as they get on the game's first vehicle, the SV Camel. It is just straight up a normal camel with Metal Slug cannons mounted on the sides. I blow up the wall in front of us and meet one of their moving missile launchers. We get more swordsmen coming at us from two heights and then a set of helicopters flying above trying to bomb us. After that we meet the captain again who calls in the level boss, the Kisi-2. It hovers above us as swordsmen leap from the roof and drop down to fight us. Once they're taken care of, two bazooka soldiers hang out on top as the Kisi tries to burn us from both of its exhausts. I just have to keep shooting upwards until it finally explodes and falls, with the captain surrendering. That was a fun start of the game, with one of the most memorable music tracks in the series. Something I missed in that playthrough during the Mosk Artillery fight was Hyakutaru Ichimonji, a POW who, when freed, will follow me around and help out by firing Hadoukens at my enemies. He also appears in Mission 4, but I didn't get him there in any playthrough. For Mission 2, Monument of Depression, we'll be swapping over to my Tama playthrough. Freely selectable for the first time after being limited to second player only in the first game. Right away I get another returning weapon, the
shotgun!
I use it to blow away these swordsmen and then blast this explosive barrel to open these ruins. There are miners at work here but they aren't combatants so you can't harm them. You can kill the harmless bats chasing them out though. As I move further in, the last remaining miner is attacked by a mummy and turned into one himself. I deal with him and a few more that rise on the ground and get going up a hill to find a mummy spawning booth. As I keep moving forward, I get hit by a mummy's toxic breath, which turns me into a mummy myself. I can still throw bombs, but I'm stuck with just a pistol, and my movement options are slower and more limited. But mummies can also drop potions that cure you if you pick them up. This is one of the things I love about this series. They'll make all the detailed sprites and animations 4 times over for each playable character, just for this one minor thing that's never going to be seen again after this level. Just the level of care and dedication they were putting into these games at a time when people were looking down on 2D altogether as refusing to get with the times. The kind of people who thought Street Fighter 3 looked like a Super Nintendo game just for being 2D. After reaching the top and clearing out the mummies, a door opens to another screen. This screen has the debut of a character who will become a series regular, Rumi Aikawa. Shooting her huge backpack will make it drop items before she runs off. Here we also have bats trying to drop pots of acid on me. This screen starts with me moving left and then right as I climb the winding path around these ruins. On the way up, I grab the returning
flame shot,
followed by more climbing, involving me being crushed by a boulder. After climbing these stairs, we get to see one of Tama's new animations, now he's more than a head swap. His crouching melee attack will have him use a spring-loaded boxing glove stored in his backpack to punch. After a bit more climbing, progression stops in this spot at the bottom of a tower while I fight waves of mandatory mummies. After that and a little more climbing, I reach another new vehicle, the Slugnoid. This one has good jumping ability and cannons aimed downwards. This is just in time for the boss to show up, the Aishi Nero. I then accidentally abandon the Slugnoid into the boss, leading to its destruction. The Nero continues climbing up this tower after me while I have to jump from platform to platform, shooting downwards into it. I also have to watch out for the missiles it fires and the moments it will launch further up the tower faster than its normal speed. Its last attack is a huge laser that takes a few seconds to charge, giving you the chance to escape to the far edges of the tower just out of range. Somehow in this playthrough, I managed to take the entire boss without dying once. This stage is important for the series, since it's the first to introduce the more supernatural aspects of the series, which the first game completely lacked. Mission 3, Madrigal of Wind. For this we'll go through with first newcomer Eri. The rebels don't notice me landing, too busy relaxing. I let the ones below me live, but take out the two chatting before I move on. After I take out the soldier with the riot shield, the train I'm standing on takes off. As I head forward, jumping over the cargo, there are still soldiers running along on the ground, including ones on bikes, followed by tanks that when blown up will have the soldier get out and have one more go at me. Soon after, I climb on top of the carriage and stay on the top, jumping between them. Right after is a soldier in shorts on a speedboat firing missiles. The soldier is killed from a single shot, but the boat keeps going until I blow it up. I get a couple more boats and I'm finally reaching the end of this train, only to jump across to another. I get paratrooping bazooka soldiers followed by tall tanks that drop incredibly slow moving cannonballs. I still get killed by one. This is followed by jumping across more coaches, dealing with bazooka soldiers and rifle soldiers. At the end of the coaches is the last new vehicle, the slug flyer. I have free flight with this and instead of grenades I shoot huge missiles. What follows is me obliterating everything in my path, including this one dumbass pilot who thought reversing into me would work. I then face the boss, the Dragon Nosuke, some sort of tank on top of the crab-shaped mech. It starts with fiery cannonballs from the main cannon that are hard to dodge with the size of my plane, followed by the minigun that takes out the rest of its health. The legs will lower, which gives me the time to jump on top and just unload all my grenades onto it. Doesn't keep me safe as it'll release fireballs on propellers that home in on me. Rumi also shows up after I game over to help out a bit. It'll start smoking eventually and not long after, the whole thing is completely demolished. For Mission 4, Return to Hong Kong, I'll show my Theo playthrough. Theo has since become by far the most popular character in the series. I'm not sure why her in particular. Is it really just the glasses that put her so far above Eri for some people? Although I couldn't really choose a favourite character, all I can say is that I find Tama the least interesting of the main four. We start the level just taking out normal soldiers and a series of trucks, followed by a big bus that when blown up drops the
rocket launcher.
I drop down below this bridge and destroy a stationary boat spawning continuous bazooka soldiers. After taking on the second one, it drops so much food that my character gets fat. Like the mummy, it limits movement and the weapon to a pistol with larger bullets, but I can still move better than the mummy and it changes my grenades into rolling bombs. The knife is also swapped with a fork. Dying like this has the character pop as well. Of all things in the series, that pop is what grosses me out most. Once I'm out of water, past the halfway point is the first metal slug in the game. I'm sure the inhabitants of this shandy town won't mind me bulldozing through it to take out all the rebels. This is a really fun part though. There are a load of soldiers parachuting in, so just swinging the cannons up and down while firing will make loads of them drop in dead from off screen. Shame I lose my slug just as I reach the bottom. After a few more missile launchers, I reach the level boss, Big Xie, a massive ship covered in many cannons. They all fire these slow-moving flashing cannonballs that are easy enough to dodge. This time I start with the cannon furthest to the right and focus on that, then slowly make my way to the left, whittling them down. But when there are only three cannons left, a massive one emerges from the front. It fires a few shells that move in a straight line before it goes back under and I get back to the smaller cannons. Once they're all gone, the big cannon comes back out and I get to work on it. I keep getting killed and then unloading all my grenades onto it when I respawn. This speeds things up and taking it out destroys the entire ship. Only two levels left and for mission 5, Kiss in the Dark, I'll go back to Eri. The first part of this is crossing over parked cars and vans fighting the normal rebel soldiers. Followed by a helicopter that just refused to fucking die, Jesus Christ, hurry up. The two after it didn't take anywhere near as long. A few waves of copters has me leaving the street and heading downhill to a tunnel that I enter after clearing out the enemies in front of it. The first POW in this subway gets me a
laser,
which has been buffed since the first game, since it now passes through human enemies instead of just stopping at the first one it makes contact with. With the volume of enemy fire, it's hard to just focus on one since I also have bazooka soldiers to deal with. After I take them out, the mid boss is a train that slowly approaches me, being knocked back slightly from each hit it takes and also takes a lot of punishment, but thanks to having the heavy machine gun, it doesn't get close to me. There's a new kind of tank that you can easily duck under the fire of, but can still get run over by. A few more waves has me taking a second train, immediately followed by a third, but this time there are soldiers dropping in to distract me and help the train get further along. A fourth one moves even faster and manages to crush me against the edge of the screen before moving on. After it is a door marked exit, but it's not the end of the level yet. It leads to a lab where we can see dead scientists with their blood spread on the walls. After the first door, we can see the results of their experiments with these mutated soldiers walking along the ceilings. These will slowly glow more and more red the longer they're on screen and will explode in an attempt to take you down with them. Around this area are cranks you can spin to lower items from the ceiling. The mutants withstand bullets well, so the best way to deal with them before they blow up on you is to just run in and knife them to death when possible. Although the metal slug I can lower from the ceiling is very helpful too. Eventually I reach some normal soldiers and barge through them with the slug and up some stairs. It leads into a sewer with the level's boss, the hose and me, rising from the water. It starts by charging a lightning attack that I easily dodge and I completely wreck its outer shell. Then come the smaller lasers. Most I dodge by ducking and I just let the others hit me because I'm too focused on trying to kill it. I lose my slug and it turns out that the shotgun isn't the best weapon for this boss thanks to its short range and the fact I need to jump first in order to be able to shoot downwards at it. It also becomes harder to dodge as the boss starts firing up to 5 laser balls spread out at once. Being killed eventually helps me win by restocking my grenades and letting me finish it off. This level is really long, so long that I always forget that the subway section and the lab are in fact part of the same mission. Back to my co-op Marco run for the final mission, I Wish to Believe in Love, in Siberia. It starts with jumping between rafts over icy water. Some of the gaps will also have rockets rising from them. And at one point my brother accidentally pinches Marco when we both game over at the same time, so we have to kill ourselves until we can swap back. After the water, we go upstairs to take on another wave before travelling onto the waviest bridge in the universe. It's Chaos. Once we reach the other side, we get a rematch with Alan O'Neill, also not dead. Still got his massive gun, still slices you open if you get too close, still throws grenades, and still gets progressively redder as you shoot him to shit. This time, undefeated, he falls off the edge to be eaten by an orca. Now if you're a certain age, you may recognise this specific orca as the killer whale character popular in Mugen around the time I was into it, around late 2006 to early 2008. Going down the stairs, the soldiers here seem to have not heard the fighting as they're relaxing and having dinner. We cross over onto a ship, fight our way up to this door, and blow it open. In here we blow up their submarines and meet the other iconic addition to the series, the Mars people. It turns out the rebels have been doing so well because they've teamed up with aliens. I really have to praise the death animation of the Mars people though. The way they decompose so quickly and the attention to detail for just a few seconds is amazing. At this point it becomes really hard to keep track of everything on screen between soldiers, tanks, Mars people and all the explosions. After this the Mars people become the main enemy, attacking in large waves. We also start getting slightly more resilient brown ones as well. There are several big waves of these before we reach the exit. This leads outside where we finally see General Morden before the Mars people turn on him and shoot his soldiers. A ship lowers down, destroys Morden's machine and abducts him. It lowers even more and tries to fight us. This is the Daimanji. It will open up to release Mars people in very cramped ships. In the background we can also see that the rebels and the Mars people are also fighting each other. It will also sometimes drop new weapons for us. After it takes enough damage, it starts to fight itself. It will fly around the screen dropping large purple projectiles. After even more damage, it will attack us with the laser it used on Morden. This thing is a massive bullet sponge, but eventually it will start exploding and crashing to the ground. But then an even larger ship will lower down and the Daimanji will combine with it. This is the Rugnamir, the final boss. Once again it will release flying Mars people to distract us with. The rebels will now get involved and help us fight the boss as well. A new attack it has is a massive beam directly below itself. So nasty it obliterates the soldiers it touches. These soldiers aren't just for show either. They fight slower and shoot less often, but when their bullets hit, they will deal damage. The ones with shields can even protect themselves and last longer. I think it's safe to say this succeeded at being bigger than the first game. This final boss far surpasses the spectacle of the first games while still being fun. We'll even get metal slugs delivered in to take them on with, but at that point it doesn't last much longer. The ship starts exploding and everyone flees, but they do leave behind Morden, who's almost naked and chained to a slab. Everyone cheers, but the slab falls forward and he's crushed. And that's it, no elaborate ending animation under the credits, just text on a black screen. Metal Slug 2 is even better than the first game. It manages to keep the same gameplay and just manages to be more without sacrificing any of the quality. It also introduces so many important things to the franchise. There's Aryan Fear, the Mars people, the concept of otherworldly things in the series at all. and it managed to top the first game in pure character and charm as well. Just a great sequel.
Metal Slug!
But we're not done yet. During the development of Metal Slug 3, they remade Metal Slug 2 in its engine to create Metal Slug X. I'm not going to go into every single detail, that would be dull, but I'll cover the ones that affect gameplay and any others I find interesting. First off, the announcer we had in the first game is replaced with a new one, which leads me to the new weapons he gets to announce. First we have the
Enemy Chaser!
A gun that fires fast homing missiles. This is a good one, and the homing works really well too. There's the
Iron Lizard!
Which sends a missile on wheels zooming along the floor. The
Drop Shot!
Which fires bombs that bounce along the ground. In terms of general gameplay, there were moments that caused some slowdown in the original version. I never brought it up because it was such a minor point that never bothered me because I never noticed it while playing, only watching the recording back for this script. In general, slowdown is rarely noticeable to me unless it's especially bad, and even then, if a slowdown can help me out by giving me more time to take in the chaos around me, then I can even be thankful for it sometimes. But the enemy placements have been tweaked to prevent that in this game. If we're focusing on the levels themselves, Mission 1 now takes place at night, and right at the start, a Martian makes an early cameo in the background. The boss has also changed. The Kisi has been replaced entirely with the Iron Nokana. A sort of tank on stilts that has a flamethrower on its undercarriage. Aside from the flamethrower, its only other attack is to shoot slow fireballs at me. Destroying the flamethrower will release a load of POWs and get the tank held up in the back shooting homing missiles at you. At this point, you can just stand underneath it and blow it apart. The biggest addition to the second mission is a completely new enemy, the Mummy Dog. Getting fights now possible from Mission 2 onwards after being exclusive to Mission 4 last time. It wasn't just the first mission, most outdoor levels now take place at a different time of day. The former Mission 1 boss, the Heesey, now appears near the end of this level as its mid-boss. It's very similar, but the most noteworthy change is that just before being destroyed, it tries dropping a load of tanks on you. Mars people make their first appearance as enemies two levels earlier in Mission 4. There's a new kind of tank in Mission 5, and we get to use a Slugnoid in the lab section, after it being exclusive to the Mission 2 boss last time. Not much to say about Mission 6 though, aside from new white Mars people. I should add that a lot of the soundtrack has also been remixed, and I think I prefer every single remix of the original. That's about all I have to say, time to beat it again. We also get some artwork in the credits now instead of a black screen. Take everything good I said about Metal Slug 2, then just imagine it being better. That's Metal Slug X. This game is so good that I barely ever play the original Metal Slug 2 when I have the choice, I just play this instead. It takes an already great game and makes it play, look, and sound better. One of my favourites in the series. Can't say if it's my overall favourite though, I can think of at least two competitors.